Hello and welcome to Cimbrer Bushcraft, and welcome to my series Bushcraft from A to Z in random order. And today I'm going to talk about leatherwork tips and tricks and tools for leatherworks. Many of you, my viewers, have asked me questions about my leatherwork, how I do it, which tools I'm using and so on. So this will be a video about that. I know I won't be out in the forest, so those of you who are looking forward to that, you have to wait to the next video, because this video is all about working in my workshop with my tools and showing some tips and tricks you may use if you're going to make a leatherwork yourself. Yeah, and for me it's a great satisfaction to be able to make my leatherwork myself. I think it's an awesome way to customize your own gear, make it just like you want it. And when I'm doing it, I know it's quality work and it's durable and will last for a very long time. So now I'm going to start this process. You can see in this picture, I have all my leather tools laid out, most of it. And now I'm going to start with talking about the kind of leather that I'm using. So hang on.
Yeah, and the most common type of leather you use for bags and sheets and so on is this kind of leather. In the translation they call it butt leather. I'm not sure that's correct. It's from a cowhide, and I use approximately, I use two different kinds of thickness. I have this one. This is about 3 millimeters, and this one is about 2 millimeters thick. And I'll recommend you to start with the thin one, the 2 millimeters. It's easy to work with, and most of the jobs this will do it. So, and beside that, I also use soft leather, and this can be from any animal, sheep's or pigs and so on. This is good for other stuff, perches that are going to be loose and not stiff. Or you can use it for other purposes. But what I'm going to talk about today is working on these types of leather. So, but before you begin cutting your leather, there's something that's more important. Make a template of the project you're going to make. I mostly design my template myself and first make a drawing and then draw it out on the piece of light carbon or heavy duty paper here, and then I'll cut it out, and sometimes I try to put it together as a template to see if the fits, and then I'll transfer that to a piece of leather. This is from my drinking leather drinking bottle, and this is for my leather purse. This one I have on my website, you can download it and use it. If you're not good at this, there's also another solution. You can actually download from professional leather workers templates. This one is for a little pouch. I have my whiskey in. Those of you who have followed me for a while know this one is one I have bought and printed out, and it's very easy to do this. It cost a little bit, but not much. And if you go into different web shops, they also sell templates for you. So this is the easy solution, and if you're doing that, you know it's going to work. But you have to make a template, because if you're going to make something and you start out cutting the leather, and then you are wrong, the leather is not usable anymore. So. So do that, make a template and transfer it to the leather. You can do that with a ball pen like this, but I will recommend you to use a little awl and just make markings in the leather all the way around, because this one, you can't remove this, but a little scratch in the leather wouldn't hurt it, and you can always remove that again. Something to when you're cutting the leather, because if you're just using a table, it will damage that. So I have this large cutting mat.
You can have them smaller. You can see here, this is my little workshop. Or you can just use a heavy cardboard to cut it on. I did that in the start.
And this is the tools I'm using when I'm cutting my leather. You can use a scissor if it's very thin leather. But normally I use this, a sharp knife, and well, this one is kind of special. I got it from my wife in presents. You can change the blade like this and rotate it so you have two sharp blades in one. Then, and it has a good grip, but an ordinary Stanley knife, you can use that, no problem there. And some kind of a little knife, a scalpel, I think it's called, for the fine work. So this is a tool you're going to use too. And always use a metal ruler. You have to, is it sharp? Yeah. Always use metal, because if you're using plastic, you risk to cut into the plastic, and then the line won't be straight. So always use a metal ruler. As you can see in the picture, I also have one with an angle, so you can use, so you can make fine cuts that is actually 90 degrees in angle. So a little trick when you're going to cut a larger piece of leather, just hold on here first and begin, not deep, three strokes, and then be careful that the ruler doesn't move, and do it the rest of the way. Perhaps you're going to do that several times, but eventually you will go so deep that the leather is cut out. So be careful that the rulers not are moving during this process, because then you are not going to have a straight line. Then the next step, and this is a matter of taste, choice. If you're going to make something, you can make it in glossy leather. You can see this is glossy. It shines in the lights, and some people like that. I like it matte, more dull. You can see there's no shining here. And to make it like this, you actually have to sandpaper your leather. So I always, when I'm going to make something that are looking old school, it's the same with my knife sheath. I always prepare the leather first using sandpaper, and you can just do it with ordinary hand sandpaper. You can sand it, or you can use some kind of grinding machine, a triangle grinder I have used for several times, because it's easier and it's quicker too. So take the leather and just sand it, and depending on how long time you use for this, when you're doing it with a machine, you will be able to sand it completely down, so there's not this hard surface here, and the leather will be soft too. So I would recommend you to do that if you want to make something that look a little bit old school and old and worn out. Use sandpaper. It's a good trick, and you also get, I said before, you get leather that is much smoother. Even though it's thick leather, you can make it very smooth, and there's a trick more I'll tell you later. Now to something very important. What makes the final result look more professional than others is because of the stitching. If the stitching is even and even spaced, it will look more professional made and aesthetic, much prettier. So to make that, there's a couple of steps. You can use one of these, or you can use such one. And I'll show you in a minute
what the difference is between these two. This one you can open here and you can make a different spacing here. If I take this and I zoom down, you can see here I'm holding it to the edge and there. And then when I do this, there's a very fine marking on where I'm going to make my stitching. And the other way is to use this tool. This tool is called a groover. And what it does is almost the same as the other one beside. It's making a much deeper cut. And what it does is when you are stitching this, the thread will be hidden in a little trench here, so that the stitching, the thread, won't be as visible. I haven't used this a lot because I don't think it's necessary, but I've used it for making decorations on leather. And you can see here, when I do this, it follows the edge here, so you can make a fine decoration on your leather using this. And that's what I have done several times with my leather. So this is mostly why I'm having this tool. I'm using it that way. You also can adjust the spacing. You just screw it down here, then it's fixed in place. And if you want to make it smaller, you just do that. Or larger, of course. So it's a nice kind of tool, and as I said before, I use it mostly for decoration purposes that way. So most of my stitching, I'm using this for marking out, for marking. Yeah, and now the other thing that's important is the even spacing between the holes you're going to make in this leather when you are sewing it together, when you're stitching it. And there's some different kind of ways you can do that. In the beginning, when I started, I actually just use a ruler here and a ball pen, and then I marked where the hole should be, and then I drilled it with a little drill, or used an awl to make the holes. And you can do that, but it's not easy to get these markings exactly the same. So I bought this little thing. It is called a point wheel. And what it does, I just put you closer here. As you can see here, this little wheel have a lot of little markings here. So I put it down in where I have made my line and just roll it over here. And this one actually had a pick here that was closer, so I just remove every second so the spacing was as I want it to be. But here again you can see how the markings are exactly the same, and then you can use some kind of drill or awl to make these holes through the leather. This is an option, and I use that many times. I also have such one that is where I can change this wheel to make smaller or larger spaces between the lines there. And this works exactly the same way. Doing the same, but mostly I use these. Yeah, and these are called diamond chisels, and I have two different spacings. I don't know if you can see this, but this one is narrow and this one is a larger part between the sticks here. So it's depending on what kind of item I'm doing. If it's a small item, I'll use the one with a small spacing, and larger item, I use this one. And this one is just with three, you can see here, and I have the same for the other one. And I'll do this. Then it's going to be very easy, because you just have to have a point where you're going to start. I could say this is the point that I'm going to start. Then I just put this down and use my little hammer. And then there's holes there. Then I'm going to use the last one. Use that again. And make it here. And again. And we are going to make something that is rounded. This one will probably be too big, because it won't make it round. So then they're using this. And then you can make it round here. So I recommend you to buy these. Very easy to use, and the spacing is even, and you make the holes in the same time. So when you're doing this, marking the holes, you have to drill the holes or make the holes afterwards. This one is making it at the same time. So I recommend you to use that. And on my Viking bag, my new Viking bag, I use this solution to make the holes here and stitch it together. And that's very easy. But sometimes you want to make a different solution, like this one. And you can see here, this much larger holes. The principle is the same. You make your markings and space the holes here. But instead of using these kind of tools, I use such a tool. Yeah. And this is a tool that will make your holes. You can see here there's a wheel. You can choose from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different sizes. This is the largest one, and this is the smallest one. You have to decide which one is suiting your purpose. And it's very easy. And most of you know this already, but it makes a very fine hole here. So this is an option too, if you're going to make something like this, my first Viking bag that I have not stitched together, but used leather cords to strap it together here. And if you not have one of these, you can buy. Just put it over the markings, and again punch it down so you have a hole there. And this one, I think it's called a leather hole plier, and it's very efficient, but it has its limitations. I'll show you. If you're going to make a hole in here, this one can't reach, you can't get in there, so this one is good for that. You can make it all over the leather, and I often use this when I'm going to make some kind of closing on the back. So this is a good one when you can't reach into the leather with this one. And, finally, this new tool I've got for not so long ago, and here you can change the sizes of the holes you're going to make and screw it down here. This one is not good for large heavy types of leather. It won't punch the hole. It won't punch the hole. So I only use it with thinner leather. then you can make your hole there. So this is not good for every solution, because heavy leather, it won't work. Soft, thin leather, it works. So I think it's not necessary for you to have one of these. The other solution will work just as good. And before I begin the stitching, I always glue my items together. This kind of glue, you apply it on both sides of the leather and let it dry, and then you put it together, and then you are glued. And this is a good solution because it holds the leather in place when you are making your stitching. So I recommend you to use some kind of glue here. It doesn't have to be such a large one like this. You could buy it in any supermarket in a little tube. It's the same product as this. If you're going to stitch the leather together like this, you just put glue on here. But it's more important if you're going to make something like this in an angle of 90 degrees, you can see here. Then you put some glue on here. Yeah. And some glue on here. And then you just let it dry. And then after a couple of minutes, it doesn't stick anymore. You just put it down here. Of course, you have to be careful not to come glue all over. I will list as a little bit in the rush here, but you see the principle. Then you have the glue together, and in this way, it's much easier to make your stitching here. Now you're going to start the stitching of the leather, and I have different kinds of thread here. This is white and this is brown, and I have some black here and some needles. I use what is called waxed linen thread, and that suits the leather nicely. It's organic, and it will last for a very long time because it's waxed. I have different kind of needles here, different sizes. And it's what you like to do, to use. I have some large one and some medium and some small one, and it's all depending on what kind of work you're doing. If it's very fine, of course I use a little needle, and if it's heavy duty leather work, I can use the large one. When I'm lacing it together with my leather straps, as I showed you before on my Viking bag, I don't use needles, I just put it together with my hands.
I'll make a little example of how I will do this. Cut this out. Take this one. Perhaps a little more. Using this one. And the other one. Then I'm going to glue it together. Yeah. To make sure that the holes are, I think it's called aligned, I just put a needle through this. And this one too, and then press it together. Then I know that the holes are exactly the same place on each side. And you just have to wait a couple of minutes, then you can start sewing this together. When you're going to cut your thread, it's always a problem, because if you got too little thread, then you have to put it together, and that's not a good solution. So I always use plenty of thread, and then I just put the needles on, and that's the most difficult task. And if you're going to make single stitching, it's enough with one needle, but I always use double stitching, so I put a needle in each end here. Yeah, this way. And then I'll show you the technique with why it's called single stitching. You just do this every hole on both sides. You just take this together. And once in a while you have to tighten it up, and then you have a single stitching. But if you're going to make a stitching that will be more durable and can take a lot of more pressure, you're going to make double stitching. And that's just doing the same, but as you can see here, I'm making here where there's no stitching. I just put it down there like this. And then you have what is called double stitching, you can see. And that looks very nice. Yeah. And another kind of stitching, and it's actually the one I prefer to use if I can, is cross stitching, as I call it. You just put it over here, and then this one, it also makes a double stitching. You can see here, and it makes a little cross. So over the on the other side, crossing it every time. And I think it's making a really cool look. I think it looks old school, and yeah, I just like it. I've used this many times. Here's my sheath for my Viking axe. I use this kind of stitching. I think it's looking very nice. And I also used it on this, a little holster for my Uku lantern. Also make cross stitching here. But where it is very useful if is when I'm making small bags like this, or larger one, where this leather is inserted in the other one. I'll just show you, like I did here. You see, this is not make this, but in an angle. And when you are doing this, the cross stitching is very useful, because it holds the leather very nicely together. A little trick I've learned through hard experience is when you're making bags like this, I make a little so you can see here, when you get a rounded shape, then it's very important that you can see I make the line here where I'm going to make the holes, and here too, but I only make the holes in this side, and on this bag is this side, not the one that is inside. I only make the holes there, because if I made the holes down here, it wouldn't be right in the right place. It wouldn't be aligned. I think it's called the same place, the two holes. So this is the trick. You glue it together, and then you just take a ball pen or something, and then you just look at it and you draw here. There's a hole, there's a hole, and it's very important down here, because it's here that it can go wrong. You just see, where is it? There, there. Because the spacing down here is much smaller than up here, because, well, when you bend this together, the spacing will be smaller on this type of leather, on this leather that is on top of this. I hope you understand this. So only make the holes in this part, and then find out where the holes are going to be on the other part. And then you have to drill them. You can use an awl, but I normally use some kind of drill. I have a little Dremel here that I just trim the holes. And of course, if you have access for a little drilling machine, it's the most easy way to do this. But very important, only make the holes on this part, again, this part, and not here. And then when you stitch it together with the cross stitching, it will always look right. The stitching will be right all the way around this bent here. My Viking bag is also round, and I actually didn't do that. I made the holes in both leathers, glued together, because when you're doing these kind of stitches, you can't see if the holes are aligned over for each other. So that's not a big problem here. I just sew it together with double stitching a normal way, and then it looks great. It always looks great. Then when you are finished with your stitching, and of course if you are making cross stitching, you can do that. You have to do this step before you're stitching it together. But then you have to use something called edge beveler. And this is such one. I have one that I can change these tools on, but I almost always use the big one. And the reason for that is because the edges here are very sharp. To make it more fine, you have to use such one. It just takes off a part. And if you're doing on both sides, sometimes it's difficult on the back side because the leather is a little bit different there. But then you have a round edge here, and that suits the leather very nicely. It makes it finished, look finished. And yeah, but again, you can do this after you are stitched it, which is ordinary stitching. But if you're going to make cross stitching, you have to do this process before you start your sewing process. You can also use, if you don't have such a edge beveler, you can just use a piece of sandpaper and sandpaper your edges fine. I did that in the start, and no problem there. Just take a little bit longer, but you can make fine results using your sandpaper here. Yeah. And this is also when you are going to decide if you are going to make some decoration on your item. Different kinds of tools you can use for decoration. I have these. I've not been using them much because I like it simple, but perhaps I'm going to use this in the future. This one is also great for wet molding your leather. The important thing is you have to make your leather a little bit wet, not soaking wet, but just the surface. And then you take this one and hammer it down. I think this one is, you can see here. And of course, if you're going to make it right, make some markings first, so you have it spacing even. And this one too, no, this one. So you can make a different kind of patterns in leather if you want to do that. You can also just make it wet again. You can also use this one if you're drawing. Then you can make, example, if you're going to make something, you can draw it first, then afterwards you can use this to mold it down. But there's a lot of examples on the internet on how people are doing these things. I not use that much. I've been wet molding my leather sheets for my knives, and I'll just show you briefly. I'll just show you shortly how this is done. And this little sheath, you can see I have wet molded it, so you can, it fits the knife. Here is the knife. I'll take it down here. So that's what's called wet molding. And lots of sheaths are coming in this way, but others are just plain, and I don't think you can change that. But if you're making a sheath for your knife, you can do this. The most important thing is you have your knife, is to use this film, plastic film that is you can use for, where is my knife, there, you can use for wrapping your food in, just ordinary plastic wrap, I think it's called. And then it's very important, you wrap your knife in, especially there where the there's steel, and if it's carbon steel, as I like it, it's very important, or else your knife will rust. So, and you have to do this a couple of times, because it's very important that the wrapping is a little bit thick, because that's depending on if you can take your knife out of your sheath after you've done this. So, something like this, yeah. Then you take your piece of leather and soak it in water for a couple of minutes. It has to be completely soaked, and place it on something, and I'll tell you why in a minute. And then you just have to mold it down here. And I got such one, it's a bone that I can use for molding it down here. And for keeping it in place, you can use these. I've used many kind of solution for this. This is just for showing you how you're going to do this. Again, yeah. So now the important thing, you have to mold it down here. I'm sorry if some of my expression in English are not correct. It's difficult to find the right translation on much of these expression I'm having. So, but can you see it?
just to have it up here. Yeah, I think you got the point here. You can see the sheet are going to follow the shape of the leather is going to follow the shape of the knife here. And when you're finished, you just let it dry and then the leather will be stay in place here. Just be sure you have it in the right shape and then let it dry. And then afterwards, where it sits, you have something like this. Got stitch on another piece of leather. But it's not important that you can do this technique because it's not very often I use that. But if you're going to use wet molding, it's a great thing to know. And again, as I said before, it's now you can put your rivets on, your snap buttons. This is actually copper, very old school style. I just got these, so I haven't used that more than once, but it's a very nice way to do it. And these rivets are very very durable. They will last for a very long time, while these you can risk that the rivets will eventually get loose and fall off. Now, this one is a permanent solution. You can see I use ordinary rivets. I'll just take this one. And always use such a hammer, because or else you can damage the heads. This can be only for decoration, or you can attach two pieces of leather together. And this one, yeah. Then you take this little tool. There's a hole here in the end. Just hammer it together. It's very tight. And then you take some kind of cutting tools and cut it off. Hammer this down. Yeah. It's not going anywhere. So I'm going to use this if I'm making something that will that shall last for a long time. And now to the next step. You are finished with your bag or your item you have stitched together, and you want to make the edges more fine. This I used my beveler, and now I will use this tool. This is a edge burnisher, I think it's called. And it makes the edges more smooth and a little bit glossy too. I know there's a special product that is made for this, but I only use water. Just make it wet and then you use this. And what it does, it makes it more round and, well, it looks more finished. So this is a good solution. Just and here you can see for different types of leather, different sizes.
and you must try to see what is good for your type of leather. But this will make your product look even more professional made. And I don't know if you can see it. It's a little bit glossy. I'm not sure. Yeah. A fine edge. It's going to dry up, so it won't be dark there. Edge burnisher, this tool is called. And now, for not the final step, but we're almost done now. If you're going to put some color on your leather, dye it. This is the next step. Again, if I had used sandpaper on this, it wouldn't be glossy, and the color will also act differently regarding if it's a hard surface glossy or a matte surface after using my sandpaper. So you have to try it, and I'll just give you a few tips about that. I recommend you to use some kind of cover paper, newspaper perhaps. But I use this. Why? Because it's you can watch it better. And then I'll take the color, and you can buy all sorts of brands here. This is a brand that is made in Denmark, and come it up in something. Be very careful. This is very thin liquid, so it spreads all over. Use gloves too. Now, use some kind of leather piece you have cut off to try to make an example of how the dye is going to be. So, and it will dry up and be more bright than this. You can also use a brush, and when you use a brush, you have the opportunity to make some kind of patterns. There, you can see, apply it a little bit at the time, so that the color is going to be a little more scattered, perhaps a little more like camouflage. I experimented a lot using this technique, and I think I find it very difficult to master, but I get better each time. But use some kind of leather piece you were going to throw out, and then you can use this. But here I have the leather, and you can see this side is I have sanded, and this one it is not sanded, it's glossy, and the other one is matte. So when I apply, I use my brush now. When I apply the color here, you can see there's a big difference. This one is getting lighter very soon, while this one is soaking up the color. So try it on the type of leather you are going to use. And another thing, the stitching. When you're applying color after you have stitched, of course, and just put you closer, of course, the thread will also be colored. So, if you don't like that, if you want it white against a black or a brown leather surface, you have to apply the color before you sew it together. And always start light. Don't use a lot of color. You can always apply more. It's difficult to remove it when it first it's dry into the leather. So, and again,
this part that is matte, you can see it here, the difference. This one is glossy and this one is not glossy. And I actually prefer the matte surface. But it's a matter of tastes, what you like. A little trick can be to use darker color out in the on the edges and then brighter in here. It makes a good appearance when the edges are a little bit darker than the inside. And then to the final step. When the leather has dried, it becomes a little bit stiff. To make it softer, you apply a little bit of leather fat. And you can buy this all kinds of places. The product I'm using, I think it's coconut oil and some other stuff, Vaseline. And you apply it in with a large amount, and then it'll dry in, and can use it. You can do it again. If you want your leather to be extra soft, I have a little tip for you. Apply the leather fats and put it in the oven about 60 degrees Celsius, and the leather fat will soak into the leather very fast, and then you apply another portion of leather fats, and you'll see the leather is warm at that moment and the leather fat will soak in very fast. And do that a couple of times, perhaps 5 or 6 times, and then the leather will be completely soaked in leather fat and will be very, very smooth. So if you've made a leather sheet and perhaps it's been a little bit too stiff for you, try this tip. Use leather fat and warm it up in the oven, and then apply again and again until you have a result that is nice for you. That was a little tip too. You, of course, if you're going to use your leather without any color on, you can maintain it again with leather fat. It will be a little bit darker, but that's okay. I recommend you to do that, because if you don't, the leather will be very fragile and it will take all markings if you're touching it with hands that are dirty. So use leather fat and make it more soft.
Well, this is all for now, folks. I hope you enjoyed this little video where I show you how I make my leather works. I love to make my own things to customize my leather and my tools, and I hope you can be inspired to do the same thing. It gives me a great pleasure to have made my own leather works, and it's not so difficult if you're just going ahead with it. Most of my tools and leather I buy here in Denmark, so you have to find some other solutions to where you get your leather from and your tools. I've seen on eBay they have a lot of kits that will get you started in leather works, and I hope you can find some that will suit you. Yeah. Thank you again for watching Cimbrer Bushcraft. I really appreciate that, and I hope to see you again on the next one. Bye bye and take care.